The Philippines is honored to host the 45th annual meeting of the Board of Governors of the Asian Development Bank in Manila. The Filipino people warmly await the arrival of thousands of delegates, representatives, and guests to the Philippines. Manila 2012 will showcase to the whole world the very best that the Philippines has to offer. Strength and warmth of the Filipino people, the breadth and depth of our culture, and the natural beauty and rich diversity of our country. More importantly, the Philippines today, under the leadership of President Aquino, has proven and is proving to the global community that through a strong commitment to good governance, the country is again on the right track to reaching its potential and assuming its rightful place as one of the leaders of developing countries in the most. Through a strong commitment to good governance, the country is again on the right track to reaching its potential and assuming its rightful place as one of the leaders of developing countries in the most dynamic economic region in the world today.
This is the best time
to rally behind the Philippines.
Be part of Manila 2012.
Philippines is honored to host the 45th annual meeting of the Board of Governors of the Asian Development Bank in Manila. The Filipino people warmly await the arrival of thousands of delegates, representatives, and guests to the Philippines. Manila 2012 will showcase to the whole world the very best that the Philippines has to offer. Strength and warmth of the Filipino people, the breadth and depth of our culture, and the natural beauty and rich diversity of our country. More importantly, the Philippines today, under the leadership of President Aquino, has proven and is proving to the global community that through a strong commitment to good governance, the country is again on the right track to reaching its potential and assuming its rightful place as one of the leaders of developing countries in the most dynamic economic region in the world today.
This is the best time
to rally behind the Philippines.
Be part of Manila 2012.
Philippines is honored to host the 45th annual meeting of the Board of Governors of the Asian Development Bank in Manila. The Filipino people warmly await the arrival of thousands of delegates, representatives, and guests to the Philippines. Manila 2012 will showcase to the whole world the very best that the Philippines has to offer. Strength and warmth of the Filipino people, the breadth and depth of our culture, and the natural beauty and rich diversity of our country. More importantly, the Philippines today, under the leadership of President Aquino, has proven and is proving to the global community that through a strong commitment to good governance, the country is again on the right track to reaching its potential and assuming its rightful place as one of the leaders of developing countries in the most dynamic economic region in the world today.
This is the best time
to rally behind the Philippines.
Be part of Manila 2012.
Philippines is honored to host the 45th annual meeting of the Board of Governors of the Asian Development Bank in Manila. The Filipino people warmly await the arrival of thousands of delegates, representatives, and guests to the Philippines. Manila 2012 will showcase to the whole world the very best that the Philippines has to offer. Strength and warmth of the Filipino people, the breadth and depth of our culture, and the natural beauty and rich diversity of our country. More importantly, the Philippines today, under the leadership of President Aquino, has proven and is proving to the global community that through a strong commitment to good governance, the country is again on the right track to reaching its potential and assuming its rightful place as one of the leaders of developing countries in the most dynamic economic region in the world today.
This is the best time
to rally behind the Philippines.
Be part of Manila 2012.
Is honored to host the 45th annual meeting of the Board of Governors of the Asian Development Bank in Manila. The Filipino people warmly await the arrival of thousands of delegates, representatives, and guests to the Philippines. Manila 2012 will showcase to the whole world the very best that the Philippines has to offer. Strength and warmth of the Filipino people, the breadth and depth of our culture, and the natural beauty and rich diversity of our country. More importantly, the Philippines today, under the leadership of President Aquino, has proven and is proving to the global community that through a strong commitment to good governance, the country is again on the right track to reaching its potential and assuming its rightful place as one of the leaders of developing countries in the most dynamic economic region in the world today.
This is the best time
to rally behind the Philippines.
Be part of Manila 2012.
Is honored to host the 45th annual meeting of the Board of Governors of the Asian Development Bank in Manila. The Filipino people warmly await the arrival of thousands of delegates, representatives, and guests to the Philippines. Manila 2012 will showcase to the whole world the very best that the Philippines has to offer. Strength and warmth of the Filipino people, the breadth and depth of our culture, and the natural beauty and rich diversity of our country. More importantly, the Philippines today, under the leadership of President Aquino, has proven and is proving to the global community that through a strong commitment to good governance, the country is again on the right track to reaching its potential and assuming its rightful place as one of the leaders of developing countries in the most dynamic economic region in the world today.
This is the best time
to rally behind the Philippines.
Be part of Manila 2012.
Thank you.
is honored to host the 45th annual meeting of the Board of Governors of the Asian Development Bank in Manila. The Filipino people warmly await the arrival of thousands of delegates, representatives, and guests to the Philippines. Manila 2012 will showcase to the whole world the very best that the Philippines has to offer. Strength and warmth of the Filipino people, the breadth and depth of our culture, and the natural beauty and rich diversity of our country. More importantly, the Philippines today, under the leadership of President Aquino, has proven and is proving to the global community that through a strong commitment to good governance, the country is again on the right track to reaching its potential and assuming its rightful place as one of the leaders of developing countries in the most dynamic economic region in the world today.
This is the best time
to rally behind the Philippines.
Be part of Manila 2012.
Your attention, please. To avoid unwanted interference during the program, kindly turn off all electronic gadgets and switch your mobile phones to silent mode. To avail of the investor kit, please register at the registration area. The briefing will start in a few minutes. Please help yourself to the closest available seat to settle in. Thank you.
And warmth of the Filipino people, the breadth and depth of our culture, and the natural beauty and rich diversity of our country. More importantly, the Philippines today, under the leadership of President Aquino, has proven and is proving to the global community that through a strong commitment to good governance, the country is again on the right track to reaching its potential and assuming its rightful place as one of the leaders of developing countries in the most dynamic economic region in the world today.
This is the best time
to rally behind the Philippines.
Be part of Manila 2012.
Philippines is honored to host the 45th annual meeting of the Board of Governors of the Asian Development Bank in Manila. The Filipino people warmly await the arrival of thousands of delegates, representatives, and guests to the Philippines. Manila 2012 will showcase to the whole world the very best that the Philippines has to offer. Strength and warmth of the Filipino people, the breadth and depth of our culture, and the natural beauty and rich diversity of our country. More importantly, the Philippines today, under the leadership of President Aquino, has proven and is proving to the global community that through a strong commitment to good governance, the country is again on the right track to reaching its potential and assuming its rightful place as one of the leaders of developing countries in the most dynamic economic region in the world today.
This is the best time
to rally behind the Philippines.
Be part of Manila 2012.
Your attention, please. To avoid unwanted interference during the program, kindly turn off all electronic gadgets and switch your mobile phones to silent mode. To avail of the investor kit, please register.
Philippines is honored to host the 45th annual meeting of the Board of Governors of the Asian Development Bank in Manila. The Filipino people warmly await the arrival of thousands of delegates, representatives, and guests to the Philippines. Manila 2012 will showcase to the whole world the very best that the Philippines has to offer. Strength and warmth of the Filipino people, the breadth and depth of our culture, and the natural beauty and rich diversity of our country. More importantly, the Philippines today, under the leadership of President Aquino, has proven and is proving to the global community that through a strong commitment to good governance, the country is again on the right track to reaching its potential and assuming its rightful place as one of the leaders of developing countries in the most dynamic economic region in the world today.
This is the best time
to rally behind the Philippines.
Be part of Manila 2012.
Your attention, please. To avoid unwanted interference during the program, kindly turn off all electronic gadgets and switch your mobile phones to silent mode. To avail of the investor kit, please register at the registration area. The briefing will start shortly. Please help yourself to the closest available seat to settle in. Thank you. Economic Briefing 2012, Good Governance for a Better Tomorrow. To deliver the welcome remarks, please welcome IRO Executive Director, Claro Fernandez.
Morning. Let's all please stand for the national anthem.
Ayang magiliw, pelas ng silanganan, alab ng puso, sa dibdib mo'y buhay. Lupang hinirang, duyan ka lang magiting, sa manlulupig, di ka pasisigil. Sa dagat at bundok, sa simoy at sa langit mong bughaw, may dilagang tula at awit sa paglayang minamahal. Ang kislap ng wataw at mo'y tagumpay na nagniningning, ang bituin at araw niya kailan pa may di magdidilim. Lupa ng araw ng walhatid pagsinta, buhay ay langit sa piling mo. Aming ligaya na pag may mga api ang mamatay ng dahil sa'yo.
Thank you. Please take your seats. Good morning, economic managers. Good morning, Governor. Good morning, members of the diplomatic corps, my colleagues in government, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning and welcome to the economic briefing of the Republic of the Philippines. The IRO organizes these briefings to report to you, our stakeholders, the recent developments and the outlook of the economy. We also focus on the policy directions in support of our nation's goals and aspirations. For our briefing today, we have adopted the theme, Good Governance for a Better Tomorrow, as we believe that good governance is a powerful driver for growth. With the Aquino administration's commitment to good governance, the nation moves towards boosting investments and ramping up the growth potential. Let me now walk you through the program for this morning. Similar to previous briefings of the IRO, we have put together an audiovisual presentation featuring the report of the economic managers and the governor of the Banco Central. And after this AV presentation, we will hear from reactors from the private sector representing the priority growth areas in infrastructure, business process outsourcing, and tourism. After the private sector, we have Asian Development Bank Vice President Stephen Groff on the upcoming 45th ADB annual meeting of the Board of Governors in May. As many of you already know, the Philippines will be hosting the ADB annual meeting this May 2nd to 5th here in Manila, here at the PICC. To promote a more open discussion among our economic managers, and to encourage participation of our partners from the private sector, we also have a panel discussion and an open forum at the latter part of the program. The panel discussion and open forum will be moderated by National Competitiveness Council Private Sector Co-Chairman Guillermo Luz. At this point, let me now call on stage Banco Central Governor Amando M. Tatanco Jr. to give us his opening remarks to kick off this briefing. Bob.
Honored guests and distinguished participants in this year-end economic briefing, fellow workers in government, friends from media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and welcome to today's year-end economic briefing. I'm very pleased to open this economic briefing, which is being held once again at the Philippine International Convention Center. I hope you're all aware by now that the Philippines and the PICC in general, in particular, is home to the 45th annual meeting of the Board of Governors of the Asian Development Bank. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, after nearly 10 years, the Philippines is again paying host to this important ADB meeting in May. We look forward to the opportunity to showcase to the international community how resilient our economy has remained in the face of continued uncertainty in our global operating environment. I hope that we can count on your support so that the international community would be able to truly appreciate this fact as reality, firsthand, and not just hearsay. Going back to my task at hand, as we open today's economic briefing, allow me to spend the next few minutes to walk you through why the Philippines can lay claim to economic resilience. I hope I can help further fortify reasons why the Philippines should be in the global investors' radar screen. In 2011, the country's GDP grew by 3.7%. I do not wish to mince words here, and I don't believe it is appropriate. The 3.7% 2011 growth is less than half of our stellar 7.6% growth in the previous year. A marked deceleration in growth is never a desirable state. However, market participants, even credit rating agencies, have acknowledged that the near-term slowdown in growth was part of a strategy, a deliberate government move to retool governance in the line departments. Analysts have underscored that once ingrained, this governance retooling would strengthen the structural fitness of the economy. This would make the country's long-term prospects truly sustainable and not simply a promise. After making adjustments in the governance procedures, the NG accelerated, or the national government, accelerated spending in the last quarter of 2011. This fiscal action is expected to be reflected in higher GDP numbers in the next quarters. As we await, however, for the full impact of the changes in governance, the country enjoys four factors that have become countervailing forces to offset the slack in external demand that we now face because of the volatile global market. First, demographic dividends. We have a vibrant, young, skilled, ready-to-consume population. The country's domestic consumption has certainly continued to buoy our economic growth. Consumption has also remained to be underpinned by strong remittances from overseas Filipinos and receipts from the BPO sector. This year, the BSP projects remittances from overseas Filipinos will grow another 5%. Second, the outlook on inflation remains manageable. Since 2009, Philippine inflation has been within the country's official target range. At 4.8% using the 2006 series, last year's full-year headline inflation was within the target range of 3 to 5%. Monetary policy has certainly been successful in providing just the right amount of domestic liquidity to fund the productive sectors of the economy. This favorable inflation outlook has allowed BSP to accommodate economic growth without fueling an asset price bubble. Over the current policy horizon, BSP forecasts that inflation will fall below the midpoint of the target range of 3 to 5%. Third, our banking system continues to be stable amid the mounting challenges posed by the current global economic conditions. The reforms which were instituted well ahead of this crisis paved the way for banks to enhance their risk management systems, adopt international accounting standards, and improve transparency and disclosure to clients. These have in turn promoted well-capitalized, better-governed, and profitable banks. Even as we have announced an accelerated adoption of the Basel III framework, we do not foresee a significant adverse effect on banks. As it stands now, the banking system's capital adequacy ratio is 17%,
well above the 12.5% that will be required when we adopt Basel III in 2014. Further, we have continued to craft banking regulations that enable broader access to financial services. This will help bring banking services to the unbanked and the marginalized sectors of the population. Fourth, the favorable external sector dynamics continue to be a source of strength of the Philippine economy. Sustained foreign exchange inflows, including remittances of overseas Filipinos and earnings from the BPO sector, have provided the BSP the opportunity to build up its international reserves. Once the revitalized tourism program of the national government goes into full swing, we expect to improve our external liquidity position even more. This will further enhance the country's self-insurance. The BSP maintains as our policy, a policy of a market-determined exchange rate, which calls for official action only against excessive rate movements. With the varying effects of exchange rate movements on different economic sectors, this policy has proven to be most equitable and efficient for the overall economy. Given all these factors, I believe there is basis for continued optimism on the country's growth prospects. Even as I say that, however, I wish to make it clear that we entered 2012 with our eyes wide open. We're fully aware that the country's economic momentum could be derailed by both external and internal forces. We count among these headwinds, one, the prospects of recession in Europe that could spill over to emerging markets in Asia, including the Philippines. Two, possible false starts in the recovery in the United States. And three, an acceleration of geopolitical tensions in the Middle East, which could heighten volatilities in international oil prices. Our collective task, therefore, is to steer our economy toward a clear expanse. I hope this briefing could help enlighten us so we can better manage the current situation and protect the gains that we currently enjoy. Ladies and gentlemen, the Philippines is a good value proposition as a destination for long-term capital investment. I'm convinced of this, and I know there is also investor confidence about this. This confidence, however, continues to be largely untapped. So I encourage all of you present here, let us work together to draw upon this latent confidence, awaken it, and seize the opportunities that this will uncover. Thank you, and I look forward to a fruitful discussion this morning.
Thank you, Governor Amando M. Tetangco Jr. And now, the report of the economic team and the governor in this audiovisual presentation.
The era of a new and revitalized Philippines continues. Committed to reforms for improving governance, to boost investments, and ramp up the country's growth potential.
The government's renewed commitment to good governance has helped improve trust and build confidence among investors to do business in the Philippines.
President Aquino's goal is to transform the Philippines. He wants to make sure that good governance in the Philippines is sustained beyond his term.
In spite of global economic turmoil, the country managed to stay the course.
Despite the negative external operating environment, the economy continued to grow, inflation was kept well within target, domestic liquidity remained supportive of growth, external sector dynamics stayed robust, the banking system remained sound. On the part of the BSP, we managed volatilities in financial markets in 2011, brought about by surges in capital flows through the judicious use of our enhanced policy toolkit. We had much earlier put in place reforms that have encouraged banks to increase their capital and clean up their balance sheets. We've also strengthened our financial inclusion efforts. These have encouraged banks to boost lending to the MSME sectors.
The government is trying to rebuild a business the Philippines has known for a long time. Tourism is one of the new engines of growth that will propel the Philippines to a faster, more sustainable growth trajectory.
The tourism sector through the DOT has achieved many good things in 2011. First and foremost, we were able to finally unify the Tourism Congress of the Philippines. The Tourism Congress of the Philippines is the organization that holds together all the stakeholders in the tourism business. We also ended 2011 with a record 12% increase in tourist arrivals to bring us beyond 3.9 million tourists, well on our way to our 2012 target of 4.2 million. 2011 was also characterized by a final decision to go with a new tourism campaign under the theme, It's More Fun in the Philippines. And we look forward to more gains in 2012. The theme is based on a very simple logic. The Filipino takes it as his personal responsibility to make sure that his guest is okay and having fun. That makes all the difference in the world.
Sustained improvements are evident in all facets of the macroeconomy.
In 2011, we've actually reaped the benefits of the good governance initiatives of the president. In terms of revenue, the increase of revenue from 2010 to 2011 is the highest ever in the last 10 years without new taxes or new asset sales. Revenues increased by about 13% over that of 2010. In terms of the interest expense that we had to pay our creditors, our expenses decreased by about 42 billion pesos compared to our program. Obviously, that's partly due to the low interest environment, but I think a big part of it is the confidence that the financial community has put in the good governance agenda of President Aquino.
Sound macroeconomic fundamentals and governance reforms have made the Philippines a safe haven for investors.
Our borrowing cost is a very good indication of how the market looks at us. In January, the Philippine government issued 25-year bonds, a 5% yield. And that's never been done before. In fact, that's the lowest ever for an Asian sovereign that issued a bond with that kind of tenor. This kind of accomplishments would not be possible without the confidence of the market in the leadership in the Philippines, in the agenda of that administration.
These are clear indications that good governance is paving the way for long-term sustained growth, which in turn translates to more jobs for Filipinos. In 2011, new jobs hit 1.2 million, outperforming the government's goal of generating at least 1 million jobs each year. And reflecting this growing optimism on the economy, investments continue.
We accomplished a lot in 2011. Investments with, in particular with BOI Invesa, grew by 30% on an already very large base. So from 500 billion in 2010, we registered 650 billion in 2011. In terms of the competitiveness, we also did very well on the competitiveness area. In particular, two surveys. One is the WEF survey that showed an improvement from 85th place to 75th place, which is a 10-place jump, the biggest in the survey. In the last 3 weeks, the results of a JETRO survey comparing 8 Asian countries, including China, Indonesia, India, and a couple of other countries in our region, that showed the Philippines on top of most of the categories.
Efforts to improve governance are picking up momentum elsewhere in government.
Here at the Department of Budget and Management, made sure that all expenditures of government followed closely the priorities set forth by President Aquino. And these were in the areas of good governance, poverty reduction, economic expansion, peace and the rule of law, and the integrity of the environment.
2011 was a year when we really put to task the issue of even playing field and a good governance structure for the energy department. We launched PICC 4 for oil and gas, which attracted over 140 companies from all over the world. Likewise, in 2011, we also launched our energy contracting round for coal operating contracts. And again, there was significant interest from both domestic and international companies that are here. I think this is proof that the Philippines is definitely back in business as far as resource development for energy is concerned.
In terms of good governance, we were able to achieve more than $6 billion in savings through competitive, open, and transparent public bidding in all of our projects in 2011. In addition to that, we were able to improve significantly for the same amounts, the quality of our national roads. It's the first time that we are devoting as much as 26% of our General Appropriations Act going into Mindanao.
The prospects for 2012 look bright.
We expect inflation to remain manageable, with headline inflation to remain within the target range of 3-5% for 2012. Moreover, monetary and fiscal policies are in place to ensure a macroeconomic environment that will continue to broadly support consumer confidence and promote investment spending.
We hope to have a higher growth percentage over the next year. The budget assumption that we have for 2012 was 5-6%. We're hoping that we will get into that range primarily by stronger infrastructure investments, both on the government side and the complementary investments that will be coming from the private sector.
Because of the adjustments and the reforms that we introduced here at DBM last year, this year we will be seeing dramatic improvements in budget execution as well as in government spending. For example, as of the end of January this year, about 91% of all the allotments of the departments in the government have already been released. So you can see how fast project implementation is going to happen in this year.
For 2012, we will continue to focus on upgrading the quality and safety of our national roads and bridges. In addition to this, we have a convergence program with other departments, and this principally will include giving access to tourism destinations, airports, seaports, and major food production areas. The other area would be looking at river basins to be able to optimize utilization of water and reduce flooding in urban centers. For 2012, we have an allocation for capital outlay of about 110 billion, which means that we have to implement this early as compared to 2011. But just to report to you, as early as February 15, we have already bidded out 85% of our projects listed in the General Appropriations Act. And actually, we have awarded 68% of these projects, which means that compared to 2011, we will be implementing our projects quite early this year.
Our plan is to encourage and additional investments into the baseload generation of electricity to help mitigate supply concerns as well as pricing concerns.
This year, we will focus our minds to deliver results. Our major accomplishment in 2011 is to reduce rice imports to 1/3. 860,000 metric tons from 2.4 million metric tons in 2010. We plan to import lesser volume in 2012. Our biggest challenge is sustaining the productivity of our farms and fishing grounds against the backdrop of climate change. We will integrate climate change adaptation measures in all the DA programs and projects.
Tourism and agriculture in particular are really the topmost priorities, because these are the sectors that can provide a lot of jobs throughout the countryside. But we will continue as well to push for the sectors that are big, such as the BPO call centers, as well as the electronics industries. Creative industries is an industry that's quite specialized. It doesn't have the scale of the other sectors, but because of our creative people, this is really an industry that has to be pushed.
The Aquino administration has made Mindanao one of the main thrusts of its development efforts. And we have been introducing many projects into Mindanao as part of its poverty alleviation program, as well as for regional development in general.
Inclusive growth through good governance is within reach. And what better way to showcase this to the world than through the upcoming meeting of the Asian Development Bank in May, an event to prove to the whole world that it is indeed more fun in the Philippines for all delegates, representatives, investors, guests, and friends.
The theme of the ADB conference is inclusive growth through good governance and partnerships. And this is at the heart of President Aquino's agenda. So we're looking forward to hosting the ADB meeting, and we'd like to prove to all the participants who will join this meeting that it's more fun to have the ADB meeting in the Philippines.
Through this gathering, we can share our efforts and experiences in pursuing sustainable economic growth with the international community, thereby forming stronger regional ties and cooperation.
The meeting is an opportunity to show the world the best of the Philippines.
The ADB is, as the theme suggests, a tremendous opportunity for people to see the new Philippines in action. And with that, of course, they will see an incredible country where the beauty issues not just out of the incredible vistas, but the incredible spirit of the Filipino people. It is often said, you are never a stranger in the Philippines for more than 24 hours. I really very strongly suggest that that is what is going to happen to all our visitors from the ADB as they begin to experience governance, Filipino style.
Good governance,
integrity,
development effort,
efficiency,
access,
conservation,
competitiveness,
resilience.
The Philippines, breaking the barriers to economic growth through good governance.
Thank you. And now our reactors from the private sector. I am pleased to introduce our first reactor from the tourism sector, from the infrastructure sector. Our first reactor is the Chief Financial Officer of San Miguel Corporation. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Ferdinand Constantino.
Thank you. We thank all of you for having invited San Miguel to be part of your briefing. We are eager to share our thoughts about how we can help move our country forward. I'd like to highlight just a few points also in relation to the presentation. First, being that we too share the general sense of optimism that so many in this room have. And we believe that based on real growth, real numbers, as we saw the chart after chart in the presentation earlier. True, there are a few clouds gathering, mainly because of the weakening demand in global markets that might serve to undermine our exports. But on the whole, we share government's bullishness about our prospects in 2012. And we have plenty of pluses in our favor. And as the presentation showed, we are seeing a huge improvement in our macroeconomic fundamentals that serve us in good stead and allow us to weather any potential storms that may come our way. Of course, add in our favor is our political stability, strong remittances from OFWs, the BPOs, and tourism performance. and there is much reason to feel hopeful about the outlook for the rest of the year. Given all this, we believe that the Philippines is far more resilient today, and as forecasts show, we are poised to do better with many of our Asian neighbors. Which brings me to my second point, San Miguel's commitment to be part of the growth we are seeing. We want to be part of the good news coming out of our country. I've been in SMC for almost 38 years, and I'm proud not just about having everything our company has achieved, but prouder still that so many Filipinos see San Miguel as a symbol of competitiveness. Over the last 2 years, we have been aggressively moving into such industries as power, petroleum refining, and infrastructure to spur faster growth. Third, I wanted to share with you very briefly just some of the projects we are involved in. In the infrastructure and power sectors, SMC has actively and will continue to actively been bidding for government, public, private partnership projects and power assets. We believe that our participation in these sectors will have measurable impact on our country, and greater competition in these industries can and will result in better basic services and lower costs to the Filipino consumer. A new and relatively robust sector of our portfolio is our infrastructure business. I think we are all in agreement that one of the biggest stumbling blocks to our attracting foreign investments is our inadequate infrastructure in the country. In a relatively short span of time, San Miguel has now a good mix of toll roads, mass rail transit, airport, and also ports. In pursuing these projects, we are encouraged by government's willingness to create the most conducive environment possible for the successful implementation of these PPP projects. Another sector in which we have done fairly well in a relatively short period is in power. We have built a power company, one of the largest in the country, with a full spectrum of IPPA contracts, and manage a power and energy portfolio that includes mining assets and a minority stake in Meralco. With our country's energy consumption growing every year, and with concerns about higher energy prices prevalent, demand for our power services will be greater than ever. Lastly, I'd like to make a point about good governance. We too believe in the merits of good governance, and in all sincerity, the achievement that the Aquino administration has to boast in its adherence to staying with the narrow path, ang daang matuwid, that has the power to transform our society altogether. Our company subscribes to this code of good governance, and not simply in the sense that we are merely compliant to SEC and PSE rules. Like you, we also envision compliance to good governance as a bridge to better business performance. We believe that corporate governance actually transcends policing and actually contributes to a company's growth and resiliency. Investors today seek quality financial reporting, sound business controls, and ethical behavior from companies in which they invest, and we recognize that a company with good governance on the agenda is not only going to enjoy investor trust, it is also likely to enjoy vigorous, performance-oriented behavior at all levels of the organization. It almost goes without saying that the same goes for our government. Those are just some of the points I wanted to make. And again, allow me to congratulate your group for putting this event together. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Ferdinand Constantino of San Miguel Corporation. Our second reactor has been with the BPO industry for several years before heading SPI Global, the world's largest Filipino-owned BPO company. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome SPI Global President and CEO, Maulik Parekh.
Good Honorable members of the cabinet, esteemed colleagues from the private sector, friends from the government, ladies and gentlemen, magandang umaga sa inyong lahat. It's an utmost pleasure for me to participate in this distinguished gathering to represent the BPO industry, and on behalf of the BPO industry as well as on behalf of SBI Global, I would like to thank the Investor Relations Office to inviting me to present the case for the BPO industry and where it's heading towards. It was exactly 11 years ago, in March of 2001, I made my first trip to the Philippines scouting for a call center vendor for the company I was working for, Dish Network, out of the United States. And it was a very different industry. There were only a handful of call center operators here in the country and roughly 20,000 employees working in the industry. And what I remember very vividly is that there was no happy hour at 6 in the morning in the Philippines. It's a lot more fun in the Philippines now. Over the last 11 years, I have seen this industry transform itself and become one of the giants in the global BPO industry. Some of the numbers were mentioned in the AVP, but last year, the BPO industry employed over 640,000 people directly and 1.3 million people indirectly, generating $11 billion in revenue, which is over 5% of the local GDP. And I believe we are not done yet. We have a long way to go. Before I talk about where the future is and where the industry is going and what the government can do, I do want to recognize the administration and the government for supporting the growth of the industry for the last 2 years. It's very remarkable that despite the global economic slowdown, the industry has grown by impressive 20+% every single year for the last 2 years. So let's give them a big round of applause. I believe in the vision that the government, especially Secretary Domingo, as well as BPAP, has put forth for us. Our goal is to get to $25 billion in revenue by 2016, employing over 1.3 million people directly in the industry and over 3 million people indirectly through other industries supporting the BPO industry. I believe that goal is aggressive, but achievable, as long as we know one thing, and that is what got us here won't get us to where we need to be. We'll need to make significant changes in our strategy to support the growth of this industry going forward. And I have jotted down a few comments on some of the challenges ahead and where we can ask for support from the government. There are challenges on demand as well as the supply side. On the demand side, while we have an incredible growth in the Philippines, we must realize that we are not the only country growing with our BPO industry. If you look at India, you look at China, you look at some of the Latin American countries, all of them are growing by double digit. In fact, India just hit their milestone of $100 billion annually through BPO industry. So if they're growing by 15%, they're essentially adding the whole Filipino BPO industry into their mix. So we have incredible competition in the marketplace, and we should not feel complacent given the growth that we are experiencing here. India, obviously, we are doing a lot better than India compared to what they have to offer on the voice side. Last year, a year ago, we took over India as the number one destination for voice support for the call center. But India continues to be a formidable competitor for us in terms of the non-voice operations, and we must continue to invest like other countries in providing those services for potential clients. China is another competitor that we have to keep an eye on. They have 2 million graduates a year compared to over 400,000 graduates a year. And while their English may not be anywhere close to the English that we find in this country, they have an incredible edge with some of the technical skills that we may not find in this country. So as we look at going for the non-voice operations in the future, we have to keep an eye on how China can play a role in taking some of the business away from what we can go after. On the voice side, the Latin American countries are a bigger challenge for us than anything else. The U.S. market that continues to be the largest market for us for the BPO industry here is continuing to become more and more Hispanic. Companies are looking for bilingual support. And it's these nearshore markets like Nicaragua, Honduras, Costa Rica, they have an edge in providing this bilingual support to the companies looking for both the English and the Spanish support. So we also need to look at ourselves and say, how can we go back to our roots of Spanish influence here and create some of the bilingual support and offer that as a service to our clients in the future? What are some of the things that government can do for us? Number one is incentives. I think we have a solid incentive regime here, and SPI Global and many other companies are quite proud of that fact that they are actually taking advantage of that. But we should not look at our incentives in absolute terms, but in the relative terms as to how they compare on an ongoing basis against some of the competition in the marketplace. Marketing support. I think we need to do a lot more road shows. I think this video got me the goosebumps, and we need to show this video to a lot more people out in the world so they can actually take advantage of what the Philippines and this country has to offer in terms of the BPO industry. We need to continue pursuing the good governance policy. What you guys are doing in the government is resonating well with not only the business leaders here in the country, but with our clients. They are very happy that the country is focusing and emphasizing the fact that we need to go after more accountability and transparency. And number four, pass the bills. I'm so excited to hear that the bill to create Department of ICT is in the play, and I hope that we can create the department that would singularly support this industry. I'm also excited about the laws that are in the Congress today for strengthening the data privacy as well as the cyber crime. On the supply side, we need to realize that in order for us to get to $25 billion in the next 5 years, we'll need to add 1.1 million skilled, talented employees to the BPO industry. Unfortunate part is we are on the trend to only add 580,000 people over the next 5 years. That means we are down by 550,000 people, and every 100,000 employee brings in revenue of over $1.5 to $2 billion. So you do your math. It's quite possible if we don't get our act together that we may miss our goal of $25 billion by over $5 billion over the next 5 years. We also need to focus on non-voice versus voice. Last 10 years have been about call center industry. But in order for us to get to $25 billion, we'll have to focus on non-voice. That means we would have to invest in the finance and accounting, the procurement, the IT services. We need to go into the verticals of healthcare and content solutions or publishing or financial services. And then only we'll be able to go after the same dollars that other countries are going after. Number three, the explosive growth will require a new badge of leaders. We always focus on the entry-level people and whether we can get them or not. But when we have close to 1.3 million people working in the industry, do we have enough leaders highly skilled in mentoring and taking the others to the next level? That's a huge task ahead of us, and we must focus on our efforts there. What can government do? One, obviously continue the support from TESDA and CHED and other agencies, but tweak the approach so that we are not just simply focused on the voice side of the business, but also the non-voice side of the business. And number two, I think we need to promote BPO industry as the career of choice. BPO industry today offers opportunities that are quite complementary to what the OFWs do. BPO industry gives opportunities to educated Filipinos to pursue a thriving career without having to leave their homeland, their families, and their friends. And I know so many Filipino executives, many of them are here, who are actually supporting their families just like OFWs. They are taking care of their parents, their grandparents, they're sending their siblings to schools. I believe the time has come when we recognize our BPO workers bilang mga bagong bayani. Thank you very much for this opportunity, and more power to the Philippines. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Parek. Our last reactor from the private sector represents the country's new engine of growth, the tourism sector. She is the head of the Philippine Travel Agencies Association and the president of Raja Travel Corporation. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Philippine Travel Agencies Association President Aileen Clemente.
Good morning to everyone. I'm glad Mr. Parek took already some of the points for the service industry, so hopefully I can fit my report on within 5 minutes. First of all, I also would like to congratulate our Philippine government for putting us in this state that we are right now, because it is truly an engine of growth right now for the tourism industry, for the right platform to be in place. It takes a good balancing act and the right amount of proaction and reaction to get us to where we are today, given all the external and internal forces at work. Given this right backdrop for further economic growth, we in the tourism industry can finally realize our potentials. As we have always been coined as an emerging, but it seems that we have never emerged. Of course, my reaction is tourism-based reaction, and I would like to primarily say that tourism can take a big chunk of growth given the right conditions. In fact, while I believe that tourism is the fourth or fifth largest forex contributor at this time, it can even surpass that of the overseas Filipino remittances and hopefully reduce also the negative social impact that it brings. On government reforms, there's a discussion of tax reform measure which includes the rationalization of fiscal incentives. I do hope this is reviewed in two ways: the correctness of incentives and the ability also to provide more incentives if necessary. As Mr. Parek said, we are competing with other countries. The Tourism Act of 2009 provides for tax incentives for a period of 15 years for tourism economic zones. And at this point, there's still no revenue regulation covering this, and there's been a lack of interest to move it forward despite urgings to do so. So it is now 2012 and we only have 12 years left for this, and we need to take advantage of this clearly. Carriers right now are still subject to both gross billings tax and common carriers tax, which I believe needs to be corrected as well. But just for better appreciation, this is not the only tax type of cost that the carriers are subjected to. While it is not a fiscal policy per se, they are subject to overtime pay for customs, immigration, and quarantine. We in the industry are hoping that the CIQ simply matches the hours of operations of the private sector, as it is a public service to provide customs, immigration, and quarantine for international flights. The Tourism Act of 2009 is one of its kind in the Philippines, where it has been made more dynamic to include private sector participation in its key attached agencies. And we had hoped that it would be appreciated that it is a very dynamic law. At this time, the Immigration Act, the Passport Act, and other related laws to tourism have not yet been changed since it was promulgated when the Philippines was still a Commonwealth, or up to the 1960s as well. We have to make them more relevant, and we hope this could be included in the legislative agenda of the current administration. In the economic outlook, we have yet to see the great impact of tourism, where our ASEAN neighbors are already greatly benefiting from. If we are talking about inclusive growth, the tourism is the key. Currently, the National Tourism Development Plan assigns one tourist is equal to one job. In other countries, it is one tourist is equal to four jobs. This is already a conservative estimate, but an impactful one already. Apart from this direct job result, it creates additional indirect jobs. Given the right input-output model, which I won't expand on further, it will show the correct multiplier equation for the government to realize its GDP contribution. That is why we advocate to let the legitimate tourists come. Let the visa procurement be easier. Right now, we know that some embassies are also potentially may close. And how would our tourists be able to procure the right visa? Let there be the right and secure automated data sharing among government agencies to provide process improvements in the airports, visa procurement, and in investments. Let the airlines be treated as conduits rather than final services to be taxed. Our ASEAN neighbors are on congruous land. The Philippines is 90% accessed by air. They cannot get here unless they ride a plane. If I put it in another way, manufacturing goods use conveyors to bring the raw materials to refineries. It is the same principle for airlines. They bring the tourist to the Philippines, the ultimate destination and product. I only have 5 minutes, and this topic is worth a week. I'd like to end my message by saying that there has to be a paradigm shift on how to view tourism. First, tourism is not about promotion alone. It requires good infrastructure development and connectivity, as already mentioned in the key investment area presentation. Second, we cannot merely have lip service where everyone supports tourism in the macro sense, while we are not really correcting the laws and policies. The key driver of this industry is having intuitive laws, regulations, and policies. Third, I emphasize the need for coordination of the various government agencies. Fourth, we are not here merely to attract leisure tourists, which are more apparent to everyone, but rather we are here to campaign also to business tourists, a more demanding bunch, but provides the highest multiplier as there will be more frequencies of travel. Fifth, the litmus test or acid test of the success of the efforts of the Department of Tourism and the tourism industry is experiential, and therefore we have to provide the great and seamless customer experience to our tourists. Of course, you know the example of our airports. So we have to find a way to fast track that. And President Obama has also realized that, and that's why he's also campaigning on how to ease and still provide security, good security checks in their airports. Tourism has been identified as a low-hanging fruit. So madali na natin pitasin. Ang tanong, are we providing, do we have the right fruit? Is it overripe? Is it underripe? Is it an aratilis? Is it a mango? Is it a dalandan? And apart from the grace of God, it really depends on the farmer. So I hope we find the right low-hanging fruit. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Clemente of the Philippine Travel Agencies Association. As mentioned earlier, the Philippines will be hosting the 45th ADB annual meeting this May 2 to 5th. This is a highly anticipated event as we expect around 3,000 to 4,000 delegates from all over the world. We are pleased to have here with us the ADB Vice President to give a statement from the bank. Ladies and gentlemen, ADB Vice President Stephen Groff.
Thank you, Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Magandang umaga po sa inyong lahat at maraming salamat sa BSP at Gobyerno ng Pilipinas sa invitation ng conference ngayon. Tapos na ang Tagalog ko. Well, many of the world's advanced economies are still suffering from the aftershocks of the global financial crisis. The Asia-Pacific region as a whole has rebounded relatively well. And as Governor Tentenko mentioned, though, there are quite a number of downside risks on the horizon, most notably the continuing and ongoing debt crisis in the Eurozone. Overall, though, the ADB's most recent growth forecasts for developing Asia remain cautiously optimistic. Our Asian Economic Monitor, issued in December of last year, envisioned 7.2% growth for emerging Asia in 2012 and a somewhat lower projection for the Philippines of approximately 4.8%. There is no doubt, however, that the region still faces significant development challenges, challenges such as persistent poverty, growing inequalities, environmental threats and climate change, among others. How these challenges are managed will determine Asia's future and well-being in the long run. Here in the Philippines, unemployment and underemployment are significant issues. It is true that the Philippines can boast some successes of recent years, and it's described by Mr. Parak, the business process outsourcing industry is an example of that success, with its growth of 34.5% between 2004 and 2009, and revenues reaching 37% growth annually in that same period. However, unemployment in the country remains high, and poverty remains a serious problem. In order to provide opportunities that will absorb the large and growing labor force, the Philippines needs to pay significant attention to boosting the manufacturing sector. Inadequate infrastructure also has impeded the country's growth and development. Greater investment in infrastructure is critical to create jobs and improve health access and education services for people living in poverty. And I'm sure that we all know these as challenges, and I'm sure that with our panels later on we'll hear a lot of very encouraging news about how the Philippines is progressing in that regard. And underlying this challenge, and as highlighted in the video that we saw earlier, is that of governance. Governance and political economy are inexorably linked to the country's low competitiveness rating, previous low competitiveness rating, and the slowness in translating growth into poverty reduction. Having said that, and I think is much better said than I can possibly do, and in the video earlier, there are indications that this administration's reform and orientation and commitment to good governance are beginning to increase investor confidence in the Philippines. As a key development partner here, ADB is committed to supporting the government in its efforts to achieve its development goals and raise the prospects of all Filipinos for a brighter future. Now, as mentioned by a number of those preceding me, the ADB's annual meeting, 45th annual meeting, will be held here in Manila between May 2nd and May 5th. And this will provide an excellent opportunity for stakeholders to address the challenges that I have mentioned, among others, as well as the regional, national, and global challenges that we collectively face. As Secretary Purisima mentioned in the video presentation, this year's meeting has a theme, which is inclusive growth through good governance and partnership. And the discussions will cover a broad range of issues that relate to this, including matters such as business and investment climate, reform of the international monetary system, social safety nets, climate change, and the acceleration of regional connectivity. The meeting provides further opportunities for us at the ADB to interact with our member governments, with non-government organizations, media, representatives of observer countries, international organizations, academe, and the private sector. I strongly believe that the annual meeting provides a pivotal platform for all of those who are interested and invested in improving the economic performance of developing Asia and the Pacific. The meeting venue here at the PICC was officially announced by the government at its economic briefing last September, and my colleague of ADB Vice President Bindu Luhani outlined at that meeting some of the key areas and key events that will take place over that week, including the Philippines Corporate Day, focusing on investment opportunities in the country. Since that time, much has happened and preparations are well underway. Let me take this opportunity to again thank the government for its hard work and partnership in this endeavor. We very much look forward to seeing many of you at the meeting in May. And I'm confident that as ADB's home and host country, we can collectively prove that it is more fun in the Philippines, and the meeting will be a resounding success. Thank you very much, and maraming salamat.
Thank you, Mr. Goff. For the next part of the program, may we now call on stage Banco Central Governor Amando Tetangco Jr. Sir? Trade Secretary Gregory Domingo. Budget Secretary Florencio Abad. NEDA Secretary Cayetano Padiranga Jr. Public Works Secretary Rogelio Singson. Energy Secretary Jose Rene Almendras. Agriculture Secretary Proceso Alcala. Undersecretary Limcauco of the DOTC. And the BIR Commissioner Kim Jacinto Henares, please. And from the private sector, panelists, we would like to call on stage Ayala Corporation Managing Director John Eric Francia, JG Summit Holdings President and Chief Financial Officer Lance Gokongwei, Chamber of Furniture and Industries of the Philippines Vice President and Corporate Secretary Nicolas Delange, and Management Association of the Philippines President and Director Ed Francisco. We'd also like to call on stage PPP Center Executive Director Ms. Canilao, please. And to moderate today's panel discussion and open forum, we are pleased to have with us National Competitiveness Council Private Sector Co-Chairman Bill Luz. Bill Luz? Bill, on the floor.
Thank you, Claro. Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Over the last year, we have advocated that transparency can lead to competitiveness and that good governance is good for the economy. Indeed, in last year's World Economic Forum country competitiveness rankings, our performance in macroeconomic management rose 14 ranks, while the rankings in institutions and governance rose 8 ranks. That combination helped raise the country by an overall ranking of 10, one of the largest improvements by a country in 2011. The role of governance in raising overall rankings should come as no surprise. In the recently concluded PPP Days conference held last February 21 to 24 in Geneva and co-organized by the United Nations, World Bank Institute, and the Asian Development Bank, the conference concluded that, quote, developing countries must do more to create transparent, accountable business conditions if they are to raise the capital needed to finance critical infrastructure, unquote. This morning's panel discussion provides us an opportunity for an in-depth discussion between the private sector and the economic managers on key economic issues such as the state of the economy, the growth outlook for 2012, policy support and good governance reforms which seek to enhance the business environment, level the playing field, and upgrade the country's competitiveness. It also allows us to focus on the key issues of infrastructure, as well as the challenges, opportunities, and support needed for key investment areas such as IT, BPO, agribusiness, tourism, and the creative industries. The format for this discussion is I will go through a round of statements from each of our panelists on stage, and then kindly note down what questions you may like to ask, because we will open the floor to questions. You will have an opportunity to ask directly from the panelists here on stage. So we have a full stage and a full cast. Let me start first with asking each of our economic managers just a quick assessment of the sectors, their sector's performance in 2011, and most importantly, policy directions for 2012. Let me please start with our Banco Central Governor, Armando Tertanco. Governor?
Thank you, Bill. The BSP is primarily mandated to maintain price stability and a sound and stable banking system. So these are the two areas that we focus on. In terms of monetary policy, we have been able to achieve low and sustainable inflation. In fact, The February 2012 inflation rate was announced this morning, and it was 2.7%, which was at the low end of the forecast range of the Banco Central. Now, going forward, we see that inflation will remain manageable, and as I mentioned in my opening remarks, well within, in fact, below the midpoint of the target range of 3 to 5%. This will allow us to continue a monetary policy stance that will be supportive of growth. The external sector, we continue to have a surplus. Balance of payment surplus amounted to over $10 billion in 2011. It was over $800 million in the first month of 2012. As a result of that, we have seen our reserves go up to record high levels, over 77 billion as of the end of January. The other sector is the banking sector. Here, I think if you look at the relevant financial indicators, the banking sector will, these indicators of the banking sector will show that the system remains sound, stable, well-capitalized, better asset quality now than before, and they are very liquid. The system is overall very liquid, which gives us the opportunity to provide funding or financing to the different economic sectors. Looking forward, I think the banking system will continue to be stable, will continue to be an effective intermediary for the provision of funds to the productive sectors of the economy. And more reforms will be implemented, particularly the adoption of the Basel III framework. Which has been announced by the BSP to start January 2014. So, looking at the numbers, again, because of the good capitalization of the banking system, we don't see any significant impact, because right now, the capitalization or the CAR is between 16 and 17%. Depends on whether looking at the solo or consolidated capital adequacy ratio of the banks. The new capital adequacy ratio under Basel III is 12.5%. So there's an excess already. So we don't foresee banks having problems, the system as a whole having a problem with this. Now, the impact on individual banks, there may be some differences, and we will be able to determine this once we conduct the impact study in the second quarter of this year. But overall, we don't see a negative impact of, in fact, what will happen is that the banking system will actually become even stronger.
Thank you, Governor. The steward of the country's development plan is the NEDA. Secretary, given last year's performance, Secretary Badaranga, what policy adjustments would you expect for 2012?
Thank you very much, Bill. Well, the growth rate last year was substantially affected essentially by external environment. And therefore, from the in domestically, I think we were doing really quite well. There was a hiccup in the infrastructure spending that we had, and that's essentially domestically we are going to where we're going to spend a lot of time. We have already starting even last year, the streamlining of the investment programming process. Secretary Abad can talk about the streamlining of all the other parts of the budget and expenditure process. We have also introduced changes that will facilitate the development of projects, especially those that are key to our infrastructure program. Executive Director Canilao here can talk about the changes that we have made as far as public-private partnerships are concerned. On the overall, we will, I think, continue to make sure that we will be investing massively into infrastructure spending over the medium term. That's something that we know for sure. There will also be continued investments, social investments, as we try to bring our labor force up toward to global standards. This will also, we hope, affect the key points of meeting the Millennium Development Goals. And the overarching theme of good governance and anti-corruption will continue to be done. We hope that with all of this, we will just see the secular growth rate of the country keep on rising over the medium term.
Thank you. Thank you, Secretary. The man in charge of releasing all the funds to make this possible is Secretary Abad. Secretary, maybe you can tell us what adjustments you have made. It's not usually visible, but adjustments you've made in DBM to streamline the process.
Well, apart from getting the budget passed, the earliest it's ever been passed post-martial law, we introduced changes so that the budget is more transparent with many of the lump sum provisions disaggregated. And we also accelerated the process of tendering the projects, especially infrastructure projects. And because of that, this year, as of the end of January, we had been able to release the budgets of all the departments for the whole year, about 91% of their budgets. In particular, the budget for capital outlay, about 72% of the budget for the year has already been released. That's about 150 billion pesos. Just by comparison, in the same period the year before, we only released the allotment of for capital outlay at around 7 billion pesos, or about 4%. But this year, it's 150 billion at about 72%, which allowed, for example, the Department of Public Works as of February 15, but Babes has an update here. To bid out all this about 85% of about 1,400 projects of the DPWH, with about 68% already with notices to proceed. So that's a kind of impact. Those changes which slowed down our work a bit last year, Bill, but this year is going to see a greater acceleration of the budget releases. But more than that, you'll also be seeing greater focus on the priorities of government. For example, in the area of good governance, we are accelerating the digitization of government operations, including the bidding processes. Agencies are now required to upload all their budgets and financial budget releases in their websites, so you can trace, for example, all the projects of DPWH in its website. We'll also focus on the key poverty reduction programs of government, especially in four areas. Social protection, the core of which is the 4Ps, or the conditional cash transfer program. This year we're investing about 39 billion pesos to directly assist about 3 million families. And of course, basic education, the president has mandated us that by the end of 2013, we should have been able to close the classroom gap of about 65,000. And this year, we're going to build 43,000 classrooms. And for the first time, we are going to tender, I think this March, about 10.8 billion pesos worth of classrooms through PPP. The third area is public health. For the first time in this country also, we are going to be able to subsidize fully the National Health Insurance Program for about 5.2 million poor households. And we're hoping to provide half of the subsidy for another 5 million of what we call the informal sector. And then in the area of affordable housing, the president has also instructed us to invest 10 billion annually to relocate or improve the housing conditions of about 109,000 households who live along the waterway. Just last 2 weeks ago, the president turned over about 23,000 housing units for the police and the military. And this year, we hope to be able to cover about 32,000 more. So, you know, this allows the changes we introduced last year allows us to make greater and greater investments in those critical social services. In the area of economic services, this year, agriculture is going to get the biggest share of increase in the budget at 52%, and irrigation systems will get a double in terms of budget from 12 to 25 billion. So, and in the area of rural electrification, the president also mandated us that we invest 7 billion every year to be able to electrify about 36,000 sitios and barangays. So these are the substantial investments that have been made possible because of a greater focus on the budget bill.
Yep. Thank you. Thank you, Secretary Abad. Secretary Domingo has talked about competitiveness and about pushing and promoting new industries. Maybe ask Secretary Domingo to comment further on policy adjustments and directions for 2012. Secretary?
Yeah, well, as far as economic growth is concerned, I think I'm the most bullish in the entire country. And I think the stock market, which is a leading indicator of corporate profits, agrees with me on this point, making a new high yesterday, despite a downturn in the stock markets of other countries in this area. There are many reasons. I'd like to share also with you that I was just talking to Dr. Bernie Villegas of the UAP yesterday, and I asked him what his GDP forecast was, and he said 6 to 7%. Many of you may know that Dr. Villegas is called the prophet of boom, okay, because he's usually the most optimistic. Well, I beat him because I think it's going to exceed 7% this year. I'll tell you why I think so. One is from, of course, the good governance position of this administration is really creating a lot of excitement in from both the government side, the government to government, but as well from the private investor side. We've seen a big growth in interest because of the good governance mandate that this that President Aquino has been trying to push. We also, from a competitiveness standpoint, are in a sweet spot. I mentioned this during the Joint Foreign Chambers meeting. The southern coast of China, the labor cost there is relatively high now compared to the Philippines. So we're seeing a lot of movement of factories from that part to the Philippines. And we've benefited already from that, and that will continue. We've also, on the electronic side, okay, our exports last year declined by 6.9%. And it was primarily because electronics exports declined by 24% last year. But for it to have declined only 6.9%, that means the other 50%, which are the non-electronics exports, grew double digits last year. Now, the electronics industry told me that this year they're going to see a very strong rebound in their exports. And we expect to continue having double-digit growth in our non-electronics exports. So you're going to see a strong growth in exports this year. On the BPO side, we were forecasting a 15% in BPO call center. We were forecasting a 15% increase last year in 2011. I was just informed yesterday that we grew by 24% last year. So this year will still be, based on my discussions with the industry, it will still be a very strong growth year. So we'll probably hit another 20% growth this year in that sector on an already very big base. Tourism, okay, we've already heard in the video that Secretary Mon Jimenez expects tourism to have a significant growth this year as well. Agriculture, Secretary Alcala will talk about it later, but also expects a big increase in production from the agri sector. The inbound missions, we're seeing so many inbound missions of investors, the most we've ever seen, ever. Okay, I was the head of BOI from 2001 to 2004. So I know that the number of investment missions that we're seeing is not really that many, but this year we're inundated with them. So there's a lot of foreign investment interest. The investment pipeline in PEZA, I've already seen it. It's not for public disclosure, but there are many big companies already looking for land to put up big factories in the Philippines. Then, of course, as Secretary Abad said, the government spending, we will try to overspend this year compared to last year. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary Domingo. There you have the most bullish on the cabinet. Last year, the most commonly, the litany last year was the infrastructure, the low government spending. This year, let's ask Secretary Singh on what he did in terms of adjustments in infrastructure this year. Secretary Singh.
Yeah, well, I hope we're going to put finally the underspending issue to rest. let me just cite to you some of the reasons why we had to take a very hard stand in terms of really putting the discipline and the reforms in the whole process from project identification to procurement and implementation. So with that, I could show you some big results, but let's look at numbers. Our bidding has, for the same number of projects listed, we're able to save 6 billion pesos out of the DPWH budget. Now, in addition to this, for example, we were able to do 230 millimeters, or about 9 inches of concrete. For the same amount, we're now able to do it at 11 inches, so 2 inches more, for the same budget or lower than what it used to be. Our bidding for equipment has gone down by as much as 25% in cost. Our bidding for some of the projects in Mindanao, you will even hear of 35% lower than our agency estimates. So these are some of the numbers that has resulted into at least a 6 billion budget savings. And this has gone to additional infrastructure projects that we are implementing this year. Now, just to show you again that the underspending is really just a delay, for the second half of 2011, we were able to disburse, I'm talking of disbursement, 83 billion pesos compared to 54 of 2010. So, as we had said, we are delayed but not underspending. Now, in terms of 2012 budget, as of February 29, 87% of our listed projects have already been bidded out. And out of the 87, 78% have already been issued what we refer to as notice to proceed. In other words, they are effective contracts, and so we are implementing early. So my request is, please don't complain about all the roads being repaired and all the upgrading that's happening nationwide. I guess, Bill, that's my response to the underspending issue.
Thank you, Secretary Singson. Thank you. One of the departments with multiple challenges on its hands is the Department of Energy, from power to fuel to electrification. Let's listen to Secretary Almendras tell us about what policy directions we can expect for 2012. Secretary?
Thank you, Bill. No, I'd like to support my good friend Secretary Singson on the underspending. Our government's not been known to be very effective in execution. In the last 3 months of last year, we had a little experiment. I had a little bet with my good friend Secretary Abad. What we tried to do was to test our ability to execute and get things done really well. And so what we did last year was Secretary Abad gave me 814 million pesos and he said, can you electrify 1,300 sitios with this amount? And I said, sure, we'll do it. So just points of comparison, in 2008, government spent about 800 million and electrified about 22,000 households. Last year, we did, in the last 3 months of last year, we did 1,520 sitios, or roughly 45,000 households, using 814 million, doing what was normally done in a little over a year in 3 months. I thought it would be good to talk about that, because this is really what Secretary Singson was also talking about. I worry because he said 7 billion. My number is only 3 billion. No, the Congress gave me $2.5 billion. He decided to give me another $500 million in addition to the 2.5, and him and the President are forcing me to take on the $7 billion. But here's the real story of it all. We're so happy that private sector, and I'd like to thank private sector here, because in our shop, we have private sector, we have the suppliers for electric posts, electric wires, and literally everything. When we started the project, we talked to everyone and said, this is what's on the table. You don't need to fight for it because it's going to come your way, but we need you to cooperate. So what do we have today? Secretary Butch released already a significant portion of the $3 billion. We're at full steam ahead. We're probably going to do more than three this year. But the real winning story is the fact that I'm told government and private sector has never gotten into logistics planning the way we're doing it. And we're now going to that extent wherein we're going to try a very ambitious program of rural electrification in the form of CTOs, which we were able to do, as I said, double the number, same amount, 3 months, and we're going to use the same accelerated pace to do it this year. And in order to do that, our biggest challenge was going to be the logistics side. And I'm so happy that private sector is stepping up to support us. And in relative terms to the overall agenda of this administration, Secretary Singson and myself promised he will build the roads. I'll make sure there will be electricity to all the tourism destinations and to all the agricultural initiatives. And I have a social problem. I can't give a resort electricity if I don't give everybody electricity who happens to be in the same area or in the same vicinity. But we're quite confident that with our experience of last year, this year is going to be about accelerating the initiatives. Our battle cry has been excellent execution. And I know criticism has been government's very good at planning, but can't execute well. Well, now we have a test case. We have a real proof that government can execute. And this is using the same people, using the same resources, but putting in place the corrective structures and processes to drive that implementation. So this year, the Department of Energy, we can't do anything about fuel prices. Last night, President Obama said on national TV in the US that he cannot solve the price of fuel problem. If he can't do it, nor can I, I'm sorry. But definitely, we're putting in place a lot of mechanisms to address that. We're reviewing our numbers as far as price is concerned. On the electricity side, Luzon, not to worry, Visayas, not to worry. Mindanao is responsible for a few sleepless nights a week for me. It cannot be solved immediately. It needs really good reforms, and it's an all-encompassing solution that's needed there. Otherwise, we're going to play our role in driving the growth and the spending to make sure that rural growth or the inclusive growth or governance, good governance for a better tomorrow, we've actually proven it as far as the CTO electrification project is concerned. Thank you, Bill.
Yep. Thank you, Rene. One of the sectors we don't track, I think, too closely, certainly not as closely as we should, is the agricultural sector, where most of the people really are engaged in. Let's listen to Secretary Alcala, who's been successful, I think, in this regard. Secretary?
Thank you, sir. The Department of Agriculture in 2011 introduced innovation in the way we do agriculture that allowed us to realize visible gains. To cite two examples, by close tracking of palay and rice importation from 2.4 million metric tons to 860,000 metric tons this year, we aim to reduce this further to 500,000 metric tons. We are very pleased to, with the cooperation of that we are receiving from the farmers and the other stakeholders, whose trust we have restored in our first year at the Department of Agriculture. Second, by focusing our investment in public goods, we have expanded our irrigated areas, redesigned climate-resilient farm-to-market roads, and introduced open and fair procurement of post-harvest facilities. In terms of value production, the agriculture sector contributed 37 pesos for every peso budget allocated for the Department of Agriculture. In 2012, we have our targets on food staple sufficiency laid out. We have a sustainable program for fisheries to restore and regenerate our dwindling marine resources. For our traditional and new export commodities, our support from farm to table is in place. We are also cultivating a crop of new farmers, not only from young people, but among our returning overseas workers. We are very optimistic that agriculture will continue to be a major contributor to the growth of the Philippine economy this year and the coming years. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Secretary Alcala. I see Secretary Purisima fresh off his visit to the Philippine Stock Exchange. Let me ask the Secretary his view on the markets and the economy for 2012. Yes, sir.
Well, definitely 2012 will be better than 2011 for the following reasons. From a government standpoint, I see Secretary Abad here. He must have already shared with you that in terms of rolling out the budget, we are way, way ahead of the pace in 2011. And we've already improved the way the bureaucracy actually spends the money. In terms of the price environment, I'm sure Governor Tetangco has shared with you that inflation is well under control. On our external environment, at least there are signs that they're resolving the problems in Europe, although I think it will take much longer. So on the whole, we in the Department of Finance believe that our ability to consolidate the fiscal position is there, and we will continue to do so. The increase between 2011 and 2010 was a record, no, without taxes, new taxes, and new asset sales. This is the highest in over a decade, and we hope to continue with this performance. The rollout of the PPP program will also be much faster in 2012, as we have really, you know, focused on doing our homework, especially the feasibility studies. So I'm bullish about 2012. 2015 is even a more auspicious year for us. We're working towards that. 2015 is when ASEAN becomes one economic community. But more importantly, we estimate that we're going to hit our demographic sweet spot in 2015, where more of our population will be of working age. And countries that have entered that sweet spot in the past have shown accelerated economic growth. So I think everything's aligning. Our effort to improve governance is at full blast, and we will continue to work on the fundamentals so that we can build a sustainable foundation for higher economic growth in the future.
Thank you. Thank you, Secretary. Some of the projects you see in the headlines nowadays, from airports to integrated transport systems, all fall under the Department of Transportation and Communications. Let me ask Under Secretary Rene Timilimcauco, give us an update on how the work at DOTC.
Thank you, Bill. At the DOTC, we looked at it very simplistically, that no economy can develop without an integrated and efficient transport network, and the primary role of transportation is to bring people to jobs and goods to market. So our projects and our infrastructure pipeline is focused on hitting these two goals. We have a lot of projects, several projects that are coming on stream this year and next, such as the LRT expansion. We have two LRT lines that we are expanding, the LRT1 to Cavite and the LRT2 to Masinag, both of which should increase ridership by about 500,000 passengers per year. So that's 500,000 more people getting to jobs quicker, getting to their work quicker, and getting to their work in a less expensive manner. For the goods, we're looking at expanding the RoRo network in the maritime sector. We're presently studying a new RoRo route that would integrate the goods from the south all the way to Central Luzon, and also the expansion of the airports in order to integrate the 7,000 islands of the Philippines. We are going to be expanding around three or four airports this year. We have the Puerto Princesa Airport, which is a new airport to support the tourism sector in Puerto Princesa. And we have the Bohol Panglao or Tagbilaran Airport, which is to support the tourism of Bohol, and the new Mactan Cebu terminal to support the growing tourism business in Mactan Cebu. So all in all, there are a lot of projects being lined up in the transportation sector. We intend to bid out around 10 of these projects this year.
Thank you, Timmy. One of the agencies which received what I think was a disproportionate amount of attention last year was the PPP Center. Yet this year they've made some gains in pushing both infrastructure and social services. Let me ask the head of the agency, Cosette Canilao, to give us an update on PPP Center. Cosette.
Yeah, thank you, Bill. Much of last year was actually spent on laying the foundation for fruitful PPPs. A lot of it involved implementing agencies reviewing their projects and coming out with robust pipelines. And secondly, the pivotal component of the PPP program was the establishment and also the operationalization of the project development and monitoring facility, which we also call the PDMF. The PDMF allows various implementing agencies to access advisors and which were pre-qualified by the PPP Center. Last year, we also focused on enhancing policies through various changes in proposed amendments in the current BOT laws, implementing rules and regulations, as well as some executive orders or issuances. We also did a lot of capacity building and workshops and trainings to various implementing agencies, including local government units, on basic PPP concepts as well as project preparation and development. As you all know, we had our parallel to that, we also bidded out the first PPP project last year, which is the Anghari, under a very transparent manner, and that tested all the changes which we instituted last year. For this year, we are aiming to roll out around 8 to 16 projects, and we are working closely with the various line agencies in making sure that those projects will be rolled out under a very transparent and level playing field. I guess that's it for me, Bill.
Yeah. Thank you, Cosette. Let me shift gears at this stage to the private sector. These are the guys who actually do the investments. The government provides the enabling environment, and the private sector is a key driver for providing the investments and creating the jobs and pushing the growth. Let me turn to our first private sector panelist from Ayala Corporation to speak on infrastructure. It's Managing Director Eric Francia. Eric, give us your view of your private sector view of how you see things moving forward.
Yes, thank you, Bill, and good morning to everyone. Let me start off by saying that Ayala Corporation shares the very optimism and positive sentiment that the video this morning summarized so well, and all the key messages that we've heard thus far. And a lot of this goes to congratulate the leadership, both President Aquino and our cabinet, the economic team, for enabling this. And it is our earnest hope that the reforms will be sustained even beyond 2016. As a result of this excellent environment we're in, as well as the long-term growth prospects in the Philippines, Ayala Corporation and the group is actually embarking on what we call doubling down on the Philippines. For instance, this year we are increasing our CapEx investments from growing by 36% to 89 billion pesos as a group. A lot of these investments will go into real estate, telecommunications, water infrastructure, and all of the PPP-related infrastructure that the government is planning as well. So we're very bullish in general and specifically in the various sectors that we are participating in. On real estate, we still continue the robust growth in development, especially given the strong consumer demand, especially at the CD market. No. There's still a lot of pent-up demand. We are also making very meaningful investments behind tourism. As you know, Ayala Land is rolling out its investments in hotel chains and destination resorts. On the BPI banking front, we're also very bullish in terms of loan growth on the back of 20% growth in terms of loans last year, driven by a lot of the corporates as well as middle market and consumer growth. And that doesn't include yet the other potential catalysts, which would be growth from infrastructure projects. Globe Telecom, as you know, recently announced its aggressive network rollout worth spending over $700 million over the next couple of years to transform their network and serve the customers better. Manila Water also is making a lot of investments still, a lot of investments required, especially on the wastewater management. We expect to continue the 10 to 15 billion pesos of CapEx investments over the foreseeable future. As Ayala touches on the key priority sectors, we are also heavily invested in BPO. We agree with the outlook that was presented this morning. We're currently employing 12,000 employees and hope to grow that around 20% in line with industry average. Even in the electronics sector, IMI, we're already beginning to see early signs of increased activity among our Japanese principals, perhaps owing to the strong yen. So this is a very good sign, and hopefully this will be the start of something big. We want to, as a group, go beyond water infrastructure. We are very serious and prepared to invest in infrastructure in general, specifically in airports, toll roads, rail, as well as power. As a group, we're looking to potentially invest in the order of magnitude of over 200 billion pesos worth of projects over the next 5 years in these sectors that I enumerated. And so we are one with the government in terms of making the PPP truly a successful one. We're off to a very good start. We are very happy with the conduct of the first PPP project, highly successful, the Daanghari project, and I'm not saying that because Secretary Singson is beside me, but in all earnestness, we are very happy about the transparency, the fair, and the effective conduct of the process, and we look forward to more of these projects. We also appreciate the openness of the DPWH in terms of taking inputs from the private sector proponents. Of course, on a PPP program front, when we talk to foreign investors and local investors, there's always that sense of impatience in the past year. Of course, everyone would love to have more than one completed project, but we do acknowledge Secretary Purisima's point that these projects take a lot of time, the devil's in the details, a lot of feasibility studies, the right structuring, terms of reference, etc., that are required to make a project successful. So notwithstanding the seeming disappointment from a lot of the private sector component representatives last year, we do sense a strong sense of renewed optimism on PPP. When I talk to investors, and we've been talking to investors a lot, there's simply a lot of appetite in the Philippines. PPP infrastructure is always the first 30, 45 minutes of the conversation. So we really hope that we can take off this year. We're very encouraged by the signs that we're hearing today, especially from DOTC, being able to really launch these major projects that have a high impact on our economy and society. With all that said, I just want to leave with two items, policy-related items, Bill, for further consideration related to PPP policy. One is unsolicited bids, no, or projects initiated by private sector. We do acknowledge that the good governance platform has a the government preferring the open and competitive bidding, which we do appreciate. We, however, would like to seek guidance from the government, the extent of its openness on unsolicited projects, given that we truly believe that the private sector can expedite and help push some of these projects and give us some guidance under in what areas and under what circumstances would unsolicited bids be welcome. Number two is balancing the hybrid model of ODA and PPP. Again, we acknowledge the wisdom behind this in that we want to get the best of both worlds, low-cost financing through ODA and efficient professional management through the PPP. Having said that, there are risks to this model. To mention a few, a couple, one is the timing and completion risks. There may be a scenario where the PPP component of a project may finish ahead of the ODA, given how much time ODA takes as well. So that's one risk that needs to be managed. And the second is the complexity of project execution in terms of defining accountabilities and roles. We don't want finger pointing to take toll on the project. Anyhow, these are challenges that I'm sure will be addressed if we collaborate well. And notwithstanding all this, just to summarize, we are very, very bullish on the Philippines. But this bullishness is not without challenges, but we would urge strong and early collaboration between private sector and the government if we are to move forward and make a big leap moving forward. Thank you very much.
Yep, thank you. Thank you, Eric. Our next panelist represents a number of major sectors, among them food manufacturing and tourism. He's head Cebu Pacific, and he's JG Summit Holdings President and COO Lance Gokongwei. Lance, I think everyone's interested in your view, primarily, not only, but primarily on tourism. How do you see it contribute, and what do you see as major challenges for tourism in 2012 and beyond?
Thanks, Bill. We're very optimistic about tourism becoming the third leg towards the Philippine economy. First, we have the OCWs. Second are the BPOs. We believe that tourism is a natural third, given our geographical location beside the fastest growing countries in the world, including China. We are the closest tropical destination to China, Japan, Taiwan, and Korea. Filipinos are naturally hospitable, and we do recognize that tourism creates a lot of jobs that that benefit not only college students, but likewise people who have our fellow citizens who have not necessarily graduated from tertiary education. So it provides a lot of local value added. Being very close to the ground, I believe in the local tourism industry, we're putting our money behind our belief. No, just in the last year, we have already announced three major initiatives at the airline. We were the first airline in Asia to order the Airbus 321 Neo, which is the new engine, re-engined Airbus narrow body. So we are ordering 30 of these, which will arrive beginning 2017, and will guarantee fuel savings and better environmental performance. Second, we had the privilege of hosting President Aquino at the launch of the our joint venture with CAE, which is the world's largest pilot training academy based in Canada. This, in a way, is a form of playing to the strengths of the Philippines, which is really a BPO in a high-tech BPO in terms of pilot training. We believe that the Philippines can be a center of training for the entire Asia. The third major investment we make in the airline, and I would like to highlight this, is in the midst of the some of the highest oil prices in the last few years, we have made a commitment to start flying long haul. No, we will be the first long haul carrier that will start from the Philippines in many, many years. And beginning July 2013, we are going to start operating our Airbus 330s to various countries beyond the 5-hour typical route distance of an Airbus 320. We would only make this investment in 8 of these aircraft if we had complete belief that the government was committed to a level playing field, that it was committed to a liberalizing economy, that it was committed to improving the infrastructure in the Philippines, because airline business has never been an easy business. It takes a lot of guts and commitment, and it requires having a very long-term time frame. So this kind of investment we would have only made under the current leadership and economic environment. With regards to the hotel sector, we are also very from the growth we've seen in the budget carrier business. We've also launched at Robinson's Land a budget hotel brand called Go Hotels. We started with a pilot hotel in Ortigas, in EDSA last year. Right now, we're in the midst of rolling out 6 more hotels. One more just opened in Puerto Princesa last week, and 2 more will open in Tacloban and Dumaguete in the latter part of March. But we plan to have 30 of these budget hotels operating within the next 4 to 5 years. As mentioned, the challenges remain the same. I think the single biggest challenge would really be in terms of infrastructure and further improving the access and the operating efficiency of our airports and other infrastructure. Another major factor would, of course, be which I believe is in process, is lifting the blacklisting of the CAAP by the EU and the US FAA. So again, we're very supportive of the efforts in achieving both improvements in regulatory and infrastructure, and we remain very committed to working with the government in making the Philippines a better place to do business and a better place to visit.
Thanks, Lance. Our third panelist represents the creative industries, an industry that you can almost take for granted because we see it around us every day, which is furniture. Here to present the point of view of the Chamber of Furniture Industries is Vice President Nicolas Delange.
Thank you, Bill. I guess I'm really the poor boy in this group, in the sense that our industry has not shown the growth figures that we were hoping to achieve over the next few years. Our industry, I've actually brought some slides, since we're a very graphic industry, to show that, the challenges we have, I guess, as an industry. I'm here as a furniture industry, but I also represent the creative industries, such as the garments, jewelry, Christmas decor, and other creative industries. The furniture industry really is now in a survival mode. We peaked shy of $400 million in 2000 and steadily declined, taking the largest hit in 2009, along with our main market, which is the U.S. We have made some gains, as you will see in the last blip going upwards. We've made some gains, but really nothing to brag about. What is of concern to us is that the reverse, domestic market is growing. But unfortunately, imported furniture seems to be is the main beneficiary, as we now import almost 6 times the volume of furniture that we export. So we're hitting, I think 2 years ago, we hit the 900 million mark, whereas our exports are still shy of 200 million last year. But despite these small figures, as Secretary Domingo mentioned, our base is small. But if you look at our neighbors, China, of course, being the giant, producing close to $33 billion worth of furniture. But if we could just be a Thailand or an Indonesia and grow our industry to 1.2 billion, 1.4 billion, then surely this could be a figure that would be significant to the Philippines and something that we could be proud about. Creativity comes naturally to the Filipino. As you see here, our superstar, the industry, Kenneth Cobonpue, shows off the brilliance of Philippine design, making use of the unique indigenous materials we have in the Philippines and tying it up with the intricate Filipino craftsmanship. Kenneth is on the right track, stubbornly sticking to exclusive distributors who carry his brand. The limited quantities he produces creates a scarcity that feeds his premium pricing. There are also a number of international brands that have come to the Philippines to set up shop, to harness Philippine talents. One of the largest, which is shown here, which is Dedon, manufactures out of Cebu. They really bring a substantial boost to our industry. Other brands include Maitland Smith, Theodore Alexander, Far East Furniture, and Direzzo. Learning from the success of these companies, I feel, number one, yes, these international companies probably have deeper pockets that allow them to develop and sustain marketing and branding campaigns. Secondly, they also make use of the best materials available globally to come up with an exceptional product. Third, they combine Filipino craftsmanship with proper engineering, and they use the right technology to produce a constant and top quality product. Now, reacting to today's presentation on the plans for the government for our sector, number one, the government plans to integrate promotional efforts focused on our industries. And yes, we are very happy about this. We recently joined forces with Cebu, with the Manila Fame, which is run by SITEM, and we now finally have a joint international show, which we all invite you to next week at the SMX. So this show, which is very much supported by DTI, secretary here, and we hope that this is something which we can sustain because we need to bring the foreign buyers back to our markets. We're happy to announce that compared to last year, we have practically doubled the number of pre-registered buyers for our show next week. And we also would like DTI, hopefully, to continue supporting us as we have identified specific markets that we can address both in our neighborhood as well as those which definitely show growth. Branding is not cheap, so we need government's support to be able to do this. We also would like to support government's plan to brand and focusing on the green approach. Our concern, however, is that there's a lot of homework we have to do cleaning up in our own backyard. While we support the president's care, his thrust to preserve the environment, his EO21 really has left us hanging. There's a moratorium on logging, which has caused lumber prices, etc., to go up, and we don't really know what the plans of the government are. There's also a lot of red tape in importing timber products, which does not necessarily make sense. If we want to save our forests, why regulate importation? Third, government's plan is to maximize benefits from free trade agreement. Yes, we definitely should try to market more to our ASEAN partners, not just relying on the US and Europe, which has been our traditional markets. But we'd like to also look at tariffs because it doesn't make sense for us that we allow, for example, our biggest competitor, China, to bring their products in duty-free while the manufacturers have to pay duties and tariffs for raw materials which we need to make our products. Lastly, I'd like to comment also on the plan of government to link up the furniture and furnishings decor industry with the tourism industry. Definitely, this makes a lot of sense. With all the resorts and hotels that are being built in this country, it would be ideal for us to market domestically. And we are hopeful that maybe BOI would consider giving the furniture or making furniture part of the incentives package offered to these industries. Right now, they can bring in furniture and furnishings duty-free, tax-free from China, etc. Well, if they were to buy from the Philippines, they would have to deal with the tariffs and the duties. Last few suggestions I would like to make before I end is, number one, maybe DOSD could help us with technology to really help our efficiencies. And as I mentioned earlier, in terms of foreign direct investments, having a major role in developing our industries, maybe we could focus on bringing in more foreign furniture manufacturers into the Philippines. I've also pointed out that many factories, actually the reality is many factories are afraid to grow large. And this is largely to do with labor laws, which maybe we should take a look at. There are a lot of labor laws which affect the productivity and costs of our industries. The other point I wanted to raise was inter-island shipping rates. It really costs a lot more for us to ship products from Cebu, from Davao to Manila. It's actually cheaper to ship to Hong Kong or to Vietnam or to Japan for that matter. Get us involved as well. We invite, we're making ourselves available to help stop smuggling as well. maybe the finance secretary would consider bringing us into in a more active role. We see the domestic market as being a huge potential for us. And yet, as I showed earlier, imports are taking a large chunk of this. So if we could help regulate importations in terms of making sure that people declare the right values, then maybe that would even up the playing field a bit. So we stand ready to support government, and we congratulate government for all its efforts to really make a have this transparent environment. And we've seen how the general atmosphere has improved. So we hope to be kept in the loop, that our voice continues to be heard, and we stand ready to do our part. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicholas. Thank you. A number of you may have questions, so I want to open up the floor to questions. We have three microphones on the floor. I'd also like to acknowledge the presence of PESA Director General Lilia De Lima, also here in the front row. So if there are questions that have to do with people on the stage or Director General De Lima, kindly address your question to the specific person. So any takers for the first question? Yes, please. Peter? I'm sorry, the microphone's here. Peter, for the benefit of all, just ask you to introduce yourself, please.
Peter Wallace, Wallace Business Forum and about half a dozen business chambers. I noticed that you didn't mention mining at all, and yet that's a very significant industry or potential industry for the Philippines and quite controversial at the moment. I wonder if someone would like to tell us what government's policies and programs for that will be this coming year.
My apologies, Peter. Just before that, I did forget we have a fourth reactor, and I'm glad you brought up mining because they were the major sponsor of a mining forum just last week. My apologies, Ed, but Ed Francisco for MAP, who led the charge to bring together some constructive thinking on the mining industry. So maybe, Ed, we start with that and then move to your presentation.
I think I said a few words on it too.
Okay, sorry, Ed, Peter, if I will continue with what you said, because Peter was made an excellent presentation then. But I'm a speaker on behalf of MAP and the business organizations and I guess the banking industry. So just some quick comments. As you know, the private sector is really here to help, and we're glad to hear that I guess Secretary Rene has had good experience working with the private sector. We've had good experience also working with Secretary Purisima and Executive Director Canilao, even in Geneva when we were there with them, to show that the private sector is behind them. And it compared to other countries, I think we are a foot ahead because we're fortunate, and because of the strong banking system here, the private sector is ready to finance the projects. From we are seeing a lot, and in fact, another example is for the ADB conference, we are the private sector partner of the government, and we're going to make sure that all the 4,000 people arriving in the country will enjoy and have fun in the Philippines. We're making sure that the PICC and the SMX will have lots of things in store for the visitors, and it will make that a whole week of good things for them to do. Other comments, really, also, I just want to say that the previous speakers had excellent presentations. From the BPO side, our only comment, I guess, I wanted to add was in terms of supply, we'd like to work with the government in ensuring at least that the English doesn't continue to deteriorate, because otherwise, despite demand, if we don't have good English speakers, the percentage of acceptable college graduates will deteriorate. And then there was just a question on the video presentation of when Secretary Jimenez mentioned 3.9 million visitors with the target of 4.2 million, 2012. If you do the math, that's only 8%. That seems low. So maybe we can just, sorry he's not here, but we can just double check that. I heard 4.2, so I think Peter, you were beside me and we sort of commented on that. And then in addition to that, I guess we just wanted to say that in terms of liquidity, we're here to support, even from the banking side of where I really get my salary anyway, but we see a lot of movement on the private sector side, even without the PPP, which we're all excited for anyway, but even the private sector side, we're seeing a lot of transactions, we're seeing a lot of deals. I guess together with the infrastructure spending and the releases, which Secretary Abad has had, we're excited for that because I guess the multiplier effect is being expected by the private sector. So while the government is spending on the roads, the bridges, and we appreciate also being consulted, because I guess I will dovetail now into the mining. In fact, we're here, we're raising our hand, however we can help to bridge the gap between some organizations or the different factions, I guess the private sector can play a role. So like what we did with mining, we wanted to really understand. We don't claim to be the experts, but if we can put people together in a room, I think people will learn a lot, and you see the pros and cons, but at the end of the day, at least we will collaborate. No? So thank you, Bill. Yeah.
Thanks. Thank you, Ed. Let me get back to the question of mining again, where there's been more heat than light, I think, in the discussion. Maybe Secretary Domingo, and we'll ask Secretary Purisima as well on their views on mining.
I will not speak on government policy because that's still under discussion, but I will share with you my view. I am not anti-mining. I am for responsible mining, but with a fair share of the economic benefits between the mining companies and the people of the Philippines.
Secretary Purisima, would you want to comment on the mining?
I'll answer Peter because he's asked me this question a few times already. We assure you this is a government that listens, and that's precisely why a certain deadline was not targeted, precisely because the president felt that it was very important to hear all sides. So thanks to MAP and a few of the others, issues have been highlighted. What the president has done is he has expanded the scope of the people involved in crafting this particular policy. As a matter of fact, the economic cluster is now actively involved in these discussions. We are going to go through a series of very long discussions, which the president's going to hear be heading himself. I think the issues here really is clearly, Ed mentioned, a few others mentioned, there are many perspectives that need to be brought forward. And that's precisely why the president decided to expand the scope of the discussions. There's going to be a first meeting on Friday, actually. We've scheduled most of the day on Friday on this topic, where we're also all trying to listen to as many views and as many sides as possible. If you read the newspapers, there's been statements about the president saying he's not anti-mining, he's not, he didn't even say no to small-scale mining. Of course, they said now it's ghost called small-scale mining. The idea really is to look for a good framework, as Ed mentioned, a win-win structure, which does acknowledge that there is an economic value to it. Greg's point is that it's a resource that needs to be developed, and everybody in government realizes that. So the role now is to create a structure where all of the concerns of all the individual groups can be addressed. A completely win-win situation may not be possible, but a significantly acceptable compromise among all and across all the interested parties is, we truly believe, is something that can be achieved. So essentially, what we'd like to say is you need to give us a little bit more time. A lot of us are trying to understand and trying to listen to as many views as we can.
Thank you. Okay. Yeah, I sit on the economic cluster as private sector co-chairman of the National Competitiveness Council, and I can attest to what Secretary Almendros was saying, that when this was taken up, the decision was made to have more consultation because it is a very complex issue, and it needed more voices from the stakeholders before a proper decision could be made. But the view, I think, is towards responsible mining. So I hope, Peter, that answers your question. Welcome to take a second question. I see a second question. Yes, please.
Is there a particular reason why the local government is not here? Because I come from representing the small guy, and I'd like, most of the time when we want to start new businesses, local government makes it so difficult. I wonder why local government is not here, because I think this is very important for the vast majority of entrepreneurs.
Thank you. I think that's a good question. We'll note that this briefing is run at least twice a year, and so maybe at the next meeting, and that's a point well taken about the local government. However, we did just finish a survey precisely to address your issue on local government processes, particularly on business permits. If I get your calling card later, I'll be happy to share the results with you and, of course, post up through IRO so that everyone can see the results of what's being done on a local government basis. Thank you. I saw a question here. John, you had a question? Okay. If I just may ask you to introduce yourself, please.
Thank you, Bill. John Forbes, American Chamber, and the author of Arancata with the Joint Foreign Chambers. I want to exercise my right not to ask a question, but to make a compliment. I've been coming to these briefings for 10 years, and this is the best I've ever seen, not only in terms of the format, the organization, but the joint partnership of the public and private sector. And I share the optimism that I've been hearing today. The optimism is not without challenge, and many challenges, we've been hearing about those. So I don't really have a question, but we did hear some specific recommendations from the private sector, from BPO, from tourism, from Ayala, from Cebu Pacific and others. And I hope that it's possible for Mr. Fernandez and the BSP to post the answers on the website in the next week or a month, so we don't wait 6 months for those. Thank you very much and congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you, John. I'm tempted to quit while we're ahead, but I'll leave, I think, with time. One more question if there's a really pressing question. I see some hands here. Okay, please go ahead. Kindly introduce yourself to ask the question. I don't want to miss on the opportunity while we have all these gentlemen up here.
Good morning, gentlemen. Andrew Masigan here from Asian Business Brokers and also the Manila Bulletin. Just to clarify what the real tourism targets are for this year, Mr. Francisco, it's 4.5 million, okay? But the real fighting target's 4.6. Officially, it's 4.5. So having said that, it's really clear that tourism plays a massive role in the entire revenue matrix of the country in the medium term. So my question today goes to Yusek Limcauco. And what I'd really like to know, Yusek, is given the problems of NAIA 1, the problem of NAIA 1 is not only the terminal itself, as we know, it's the runway capacity. So what I would like to know is what would be the medium-term remedy and where is the strategy going in as far as increasing our capacities to absorb more tourists, more in-flight, more flights going to and from the country?
Thank you, Andrew. As the immediate and obvious solution to the NAIA 1 capacity problem, as you know, is the runway. We are building two rapid exit taxiways in order to increase the runway events from existing 36 events per hour to increase it to 45. That would bring us to something like about a takeoff and landing every 1 minute and 30 seconds. But that is a palliative solution. In the long term, as the Secretary Ross has announced, the long-term solution is to expand the airport in Clark, because that is the solution which will support the tourism growth for the next 20, 30 years. The whole problem with NAIA, it's just the physical constraint of runway, and there's just no more space.
And speaking of which, will the renovation, the physical renovation, aesthetically at least, of NAIA 1 happen this year?
Yes, it's already ongoing. We've allotted 1.2 billion for that physical renovation for Terminal 1. And we also, I think 2 months ago, Changi was here with us to help us look at the problems and see what would be the good solution in order to improve the aesthetics and the functionality of Terminal 1. So we are doing it with doing it quickly and doing it with world-class help.
Thank you, Yusek Limkaw.
Yep, thank you. Lance, did you want to add anything to that?
I think from a tourism perspective, clearly the everything's moving forward. I think the single largest bottleneck that we will face as a country is that our main gateway, Manila International Airport, NAIA, is really capacity limited, not purely from a terminal side, but really from a runway perspective side. NAIA has two cross runways, and I think it has historically run at between 40 to 45 movements per hour. I think the group of Timmy and Secretary Rojas are already taking initiatives to increase the capacity there, including the introduction of rapid exit taxiways. I think the second major step that can be taken is that the general aviation, which consists of 16 to 17% of all takeoff and landings there, might have to be moved for, as we are allocating a scarce national resource, which is takeoff movements to planes with 10 seats and below, no? And I don't see any other major gateway in Asia which allows private planes to operate in their main gateway. So essentially in the Philippines, we're treating a 747 the same as a Cessna. So I think, but I think the Department of Transportation has already made pronouncements that they will move general aviation in the next couple of years. I do believe, though, that there are several things we can do. One is to continue to improve NAIA by employing the latest technology possible. But also, I think, as Timmy mentioned earlier, they're also taking certain steps to improve all the secondary airports so that tourists from abroad do not have to go to Manila before going to their final destination, like Boracay, Cebu, Davao, Puerto Princesa. Right now, we have a limited resource. So I think, in terms of takeoff and landing, so we have to allocate that properly.
Thanks, Lance. Let me take just one last question here from this lady. Yep, please go ahead.
I'd like to ask, why is Congress not represented here when most of the reforms require legislation? And is population not an issue or not a concern of the administration? And lastly, for the OF, what is your alternative if Congress does not pass new tax laws? That's all.
Okay, I guess to the first question on Congress, we'll note that as well, just like the question on LGUs, and maybe in the future we can change the panel a little bit. Secretary Purisma, last question on alternatives if Congress does not pass new tax laws.
Well, the President has a very good working relationship with Congress. As you know, the coalition of the President controls both houses. In fact, there are two bills right now that are being taken up by Congress. That's the rationalization of the incentives bill, which is already in the Senate, and then the syntax bill, which is being debated right now in Congress. We will continue to work with them, but at the same time, continue to focus on improving efficiency. As the World Bank estimates, there's still around 4% of GDP out there that we can collect, and I'm sure Commissioner Henares and Commissioner Biason have their eyes focused on that. So we will continue to improve our revenue to our tax effort, you know, so that we reach a point where we really are comfortable with our debt sustainability. Thank you.
Thank you. Let me finally pass off this last tough question on RH bill to Secretary Abad. The view of is sorry to throw you a curveball there, Butch, but there was a question about is population important or not.
Well, the good news is recently we got an indication from the Catholic Church hierarchy that once again they're open to a dialogue with the government. We had that going on, and we were in fact progressing on that until abruptly it ended. But just recently, there is that opening now for discussions, and they're willing to sit down again. And the committee is prepared to make a report in the House, but I guess with these discussions possible now, it's looking good that we may be able to see some movements along this measure. And just recently, the president was into a succession of meetings with religious leaders, and hopefully we can finally get the process going again.
Okay, thank you, Butch. Well, on that note, let me close off this panel discussion and try to just summarize in a few quick points. The first, I think, as you've seen just from the very beginning of the forum today all the way to this panel discussion, a lot of private sector recommendations, which I believe IRO has taken note of and will be distributed. But the key message has been that there have been governance reforms. There's more transparency and accountability in the system. There have been improvements in the budget process in terms of streamlining that process. There are improvements in the process at both the national government agency level and I might add at the LGU level. Part of this improvement has been in the acceleration of procurement. I think they want to lay to rest the accusation or the allegation of no more underspending. I think what you've seen is a faster spending, certainly on the infrastructure side. That should be good for growth and good for the competitiveness of the country. Please join me in thanking our panelists, all our private and public sector panelists this morning, for their views. And now let me turn over to IRO Director Claro Fernandez.
Thank you, Bill. And I request the panelists to please stay in your seats while I now call on Secretary Purisima to deliver the closing remarks, sir.
The economic agenda of President Aquino is sometimes referred to as Aquinomics. And economics is really anchored on improving the governance environment in the country. In 2011, we've started to reap the dividends of better governance. In the area of taxation, our revenues increased by almost 13%, which is the best in over 10 years without new taxes and asset sales. Our interest cost was almost $1 billion less than our program. In the area of implementing projects, the DPWH and the other implementing agencies were able to realize substantial savings and improve the quality of project. But the bigger dividend in economics is really the increased confidence of the business community. And today we've heard from some of our major groups about their very optimistic plans for the future. That is at the heart of economics, to create an environment that is fair, that is transparent, that is predictable, so that the resources, the talent, and the capital of the private sector can be mobilized. The biggest dividend, of course, for economics is creating an environment for sustainable economic growth that will allow us to continue to improve our people's lives and ultimately eradicate poverty. Before I close, I'd like to recognize a few faces of good governance that's not in the cabinet, no, First, I'd like to recognize Director General De Lima, no, head of PESA. The PESA has been under her care for many, many years, and those of you who operate under the PESA environment wish that the whole country were a PESA. So I think our goal is to continue to create an environment that is more conducive to doing business in the Philippines. But of course, my seatmate, Commissioner Henares, under her leadership, the revenue collection of BIR has dramatically increased. And this year, she commits again that she will beat 2011's performance. And I'm confident that with her focus on making it more fun to pay taxes in the Philippines, then we will hit that target. Finally, I'd like to recognize my idol, Governor Tetangco, who's been at the helm of kita mo, siya lang may palakpak. Who's been at the helm of the Central Bank the past, 7 years? 7 years, and he's brought better governance in the regulation of the financial industry, and also more confidence in the macroeconomic environment of the country. And I'd like to thank him also for hosting this event. As you know, the PICC is owned by the Central Bank of the Philippines. To our private sector panelists and respondents, we thank you for spending a big part of your morning with us, and for your comments and suggestions. We will certainly address that. And to my colleagues in the government for, again, spending a major part of their schedule today to be with you. And, of course, to you for coming all the way here to the Bay Area so that you can be part of this economic briefing. The reason we moved it here, of course, it's free with the PICC, but we want you to get used to coming here, coming over to the PICC, because it will be here where we will be hosting the ADB meeting this coming May 2 to 5, and we hope that you will be participating. We're looking forward to this very major event where we expect over 4,000 delegates to participate, so that we can showcase the work so far of the Aquino administration, the dividends, and the prospect of better governance in the Philippines. Again, thank you, and have a good day.
Thank you, Secretary Purisima. We also like to thank our economic managers, of course, Governor Tetangco, our reactors, panelists from the private sector, Mr. Bill Luz, of course, and all our guests for their time this morning. May I remind all panelists and our moderator, Bill, please remain on stage for a photo op. At this point, we'd like to acknowledge the assistance of those who have helped the IRO put this briefing together, specifically our colleagues at the BSP, and our counterparts from the NEDA, from the Finance Department, Trade Department, and the Budget Department. We'd also like to acknowledge the NEDA Development Information staff who assisted us in the registration this morning. May also remind everyone to please fill up our feedback form to give us a better idea of how we'll do this again next time. Lastly, we'd like to invite our guests to partake of our snacks at the lounge, and for our friends from the media to join us in a press conference next door at Summit Hall E and F. Again, thank you for your presence today and your continued support to the Philippine economy. We look forward to your presence in our next briefing. Thank you very much.